I don't think there was anybody else like him in my lifetime. And before that, writers were not allowed such a wide range of activities he managed to encompass.
I think he was great because he tackled everything that came into his ken. He invented a verbal form with which to tackle it, and simply because of his energy.
What seemed to me to be extraordinary about Anthony is that the whole body of work represents the man, and that to say, you know, Earthly Powers is the masterpiece or the Enderby trilogy is what he'll be remembered by, is in a way to ignore this prodigious fecundity and this prodigious invention that never seemed to dry out. I mean, one was in awe of it.
I think it's a disease. I'm not proud of it, but the impulse to write has become overriding and prevents my doing anything else. I mean, I don't play golf. I think I should be playing golf. I should be thinking of buying a small yacht. I don't know. Other people do these things and enjoy them, but the urge to work has become very much a habit. On the other hand, I would say this, that it becomes easier than the many outsiders think. If you say to yourself, right, I'm going to produce 1,000 words a day, 365 days of the year, of course you will produce, I think, probably about half of War and Peace in a single year. You can write 1,000 words a day of the book you're currently working on and then have a great deal of spare time left, in which time you want to do something else. I write music, but which is a kind of knitting for me. I put the score on my knee and watch the television and write my scores.
Anthony Burgess remains little known as a composer, but is widely recognised as one of the most extraordinary writers of the 20th century. He was the author of over 50 books and was as remarkable for the range of his interests as for his sheer productivity. A late starter in the art of fiction, he wrote in almost every genre, including social satire, science fiction, spy novels, and historical epics.
One of the extraordinary things about Burgess is that he'll write a novel about the Roman Empire, or he'll write a novel about Shakespeare, or he'll write a novel about the death of Marlowe, or he'll write a novel about Mozart, or he'll write a novel about Keats. He just looks around the world and thinks, I can get a novel out of that. He doesn't regard the contemporary world as the right, proper, and only subject matter.
Throughout his work, Burgess would return again and again to three obsessions: language, music, and the conflict of good and evil, a preoccupation which had its roots in the Catholic faith he had abandoned as a young man.
I was brought up a Catholic, and I remember writing a book that became undeservedly popular. They made a film out of it called A Clockwork Orange. I didn't know why I was writing it, but when I'd written it, I saw why I was writing it. It was because I was concerned with presenting a theme which was very much part of my background. It's the theme of a man's free will, the existence of good and evil, the necessity to choose between the two, because if we are creatures of choice, we must have two things to choose between. And this, I think, I see now has become a fairly consistent theme in my writing.
Burgess became exasperated by his constant association with A Clockwork Orange, a work he often dismissed as minor. It was the only one of his novels to be made into a film, directed by Stanley Kubrick in 1971. The novel was partly inspired by the juvenile delinquency of the late 50s and early 60s. Set in a Britain of the future, both book and film are narrated by the Beethoven-loving hero Alex, the leader of a gang of teenage thugs who beat, rape, and murder.
I had to write about real youths, real kids who were knocking each other about, and I tried to write it in the slang of the time, but I realized that By the time the book was published, if it ever got published, the slang would already be out of date, so I had to invent a slang. And if you invent a slang, of course, it has no chance of becoming out of date because it doesn't really exist.
What's it going to be then, eh? There was me, that is Alex, and my three droogs, that is Pete, Georgie and Dim. Dim being really Dim. And we sat in the Corova milk bar, making up our rassodox what to do with the evening. Our pockets were full of deng, so there was no real need, from the point of view of Crastin any more Pretty Polly, to tall-chop some old Beck in an alley and vidy him swim in his blood while we counted the take-ins and divided by four.
The language in which Alex tells his story is called Nadsat, an imaginary teenage dialect devised by Burgess from his studies of Russian.
To be honest with you, I struggled a bit through Clockwork Orange. I think it was, you know, having to thumb back to the dictionary in the end, the glossary or whatever, and you know, I couldn't really understand what the hell it was about. But on the second reading, I could tell that it was a very major piece of work. And on the third reading, I was absolutely blown away by it and thought it was one of the most remarkable pieces of work I'd read.
Kubrick's film exploited to the full Alex's exotic language and his adoration of classical music.
And it was like, for a moment, oh my brothers, some great bird had flown into the milk bar. And I felt all the melanky little hairs on my plot standing endwise, and the shivers crawling up like slow melanky lizards, and then down again. Because I knew what she sang. It was a bit from The Glorious Ninth by Ludwig van.
It is a novel which wants to know why people commit gratuitous acts of evil. It gets quite a long way towards understanding it, and he then has the guts to defend his free will.
There was talk already at that time, going back 20-odd years, about the possibility of curing violence by taking over these young hooligans, these young thugs, and subjecting them to a psychological process of conditioning which would make them good. And that's what I show in the book, and indeed that's what's shown in the film.
When it came to the sixth or seventh Malchik leering and smecking and then going into it, I began to feel really sick. But I could not shut me glazies. And even if I tried to move my glass balls about, I still could not get out of the line of fire of this picture.
Get me up. I want to be sick. Get something for me to be sick in.
Very soon now, the drug will cause the subject to experience a death-like paralysis, together with deep feelings of terror and helplessness. One of our early test subjects described it as being like death, a sense of stifling or drowning. And it is during this period we have found that the subject will make his most rewarding associations between his catastrophic experience and violent and the violence he sees.
Leave me glasses!
I remember when it opened, the film, there were editorials from the sort of liberals, you know, about, because they couldn't help kind of like the character, but there he was, raping and beating and God knows what else, and you end up feeling sorry for him. Because you only end up feeling sorry for him because the bigger issue is the right to choose. And to choose, even though he's bad, let him be bad, rather than alter his brain and make him into an automaton.
The theological dimension of Burgess's novel was largely lost in ferocious arguments over the film's apparent glamorization of violence.
I became associated with violence chiefly because of the film, and if a couple of nuns were raped in Berwick-on-Tweed, I would always get a telephone call from a newspaper, you know, Mr. Burgess, what do you think of this? Do you not feel in some measure responsible? Stanley, they would never telephone you, Stanley, because you keep out of the way.
And I've had to deal with this all over the world.
Yeah.
So in consequence, they've turned me into a kind of expert on violence, which I really know nothing about.
Burgess made comedy of his unwanted notoriety in his 1974 novel, The Clockwork Testament.
Oh, Mr. Enderby?
Professor Enderby speaking.
Oh, hi. This is the Spur Lansing Show. We wondered if you...
What? Who? What is this?
The Spur Lansing Show. Talk show. Television. The talk show.
Oh.
It's the movie, The Deutschland.
But I only wrote the... I mean, it was only my idea. They've been attacking it, have they?
No. Some boys have been attacking some nuns. In Manhattanville? I'm shocked you didn't know. I assumed...
Nuns are always being attacked. Their purity is an affront to the dirty world.
Oh, remember that. Remember to say that. But the point is that they said they wouldn't have done it if they hadn't seen the movie. That's why we're...
I see. Always blame art, eh? Not original sin, but art. You ignore art as so much unnecessary garbage, or you blame it for your own crimes. That's the way of it. I'll get the bastards, all of them. I'm not having this sort of nonsense, do you hear? There was silence at the other end. You never take art for what it is. Beauty, ultimate meaning, form for its own sake, self-subsisting. Oh, no. It's always got to be either sneered at or attacked as evil. I'll have my bloody say. What's the name of the show again? But she'd rung off. Silly bitch.
My next guest lives in Monte Carlo. He speaks 7 languages, 8 if you include English, 10 if you include the languages he created for the films Clockwork Orange and The Quest for Fire. The phrase makers have called my final guest our most prolific polymath. First volume of his autobiography, Little Wilson and Big God, is published this week in paperback. A young musical prodigy, a prolific and successful author, a journalist, a critic, a linguist, a reviewer, screenwriter, now a playwright, and someone I'm delighted to welcome to Wogan, Anthony Burgess.
I never heard him complain about the publicity round he had to do for his books. And that publicity round became more and more demanding as people realised that he was good value. But I think that in his television, radio and other appearances, as in his books, being a showman was part of what he really enjoyed.
The only exercise I ever take is just tapping away at a typewriter, except for sexual exercise. That's allowed. Indeed, I had a friend who's...
It's not good for you, though.
Sexual exercise, excellent for you.
Is it good for you?
First class.
Oh, I gave it up. What do you know about it?
Well, I had a friend with a slight heart condition, and his doctor said, sexual exercise is all right, as long as it's not too exciting, so do it with your wife and nobody else. Which was a bit of an insult to the wife.
There was something very unbuttoned and bawdy and open about him. I remember one time when he was complaining about how impossible it was to sell books, how people were much more interested in manuscripts than in books. And he was laughing about how he liked to put coffee stains on the manuscript and a bit of semen and this and that, so as to make them more valuable to collectors.
My mind's all right, I think.
Yes,
I think
it sounds pretty good to me.
Oh, thank you.
He's a bit sexually obsessed, certainly, but...
Well, I mean, that's part of our Catholic training, but...
certainly. Look, I mean, if you look back on your early life, which you have certainly written in so colourfully...
Thank you.
It was all true.
It's all true. One doesn't lie. I mean, telling the truth totally. The trouble, I think, with writing your own memoirs or autobiography is you want to please the reader. You don't want to bore the reader, and so you tend to miss out the bits that are dull. So if you read my book, you'll find that it's exciting. It's all sex, nothing else. Yeah. The things that happen between the sexual bouts are just not mentioned. You don't recall.
I think the autobiographies are tremendous books. I mean, maybe they should be classified as works of fiction because it's so much Anthony taking his life and shaping it. He's a great cover-up of tracks and traces, Anthony. I mean, there were very few photographs of him before, I don't know, the mid-60s, and he claimed they'd all been eaten by termites in Malaya or something like that, but I suspect there was something more guileful and covert going on.
Anthony Burgess was a pseudonym of John Burgess Wilson, born to a working-class Catholic family in Manchester in 1917. Anthony was his confirmation name, Burgess the maiden name of his mother.
Oh, Bertie,
Although she was a minor music hall star, known as the beautiful Belle Burgess, no photographs of her appear to have survived, and her son had no direct memory of her.
At the end of the First World War, 1918, the influenza epidemic ravaged Europe, and in 1 week my mother and my sister died. Indeed, my father came home from his barracks in Preston to find both my mother and my sister lying dead on the bed, on their respective beds, while I was gurgling in my cradle. I was obviously destined for something, God knows what, but for something.
In the psychiatrist's chair, Anthony Burgess talks to Dr. Anthony Clare.
The earliest years, as you know, they're the ones that fascinate people like me. Mm. In your case, as you well know, they are dramatic in the sense that you were motherless from 18 months.
Yes, I've often wondered how important this is, because when I began to read Freud, Freud laid so much emphasis on the relationship of the child with the mother. Indeed, he set up this whole highly dramatic, this Greek tragedy, in effect, the Oedipus complex, the war with the father, and so on. I don't think this could have happened in my own life, because I never had a mother substitute, and my relations with my father were rather lukewarm, and I had to grow up without something which I rather envied most other people. You know, the mother, the home atmosphere. I wonder whether this does anything to one in adult life, whether one becomes colder or less able to give affection or you need to take affection, because one never had this early filial experience. I think I've said in the...
It didn't sound as if it was a very warm early childhood. Let's put it that way. Rationally, he was a bright little boy, and therefore it had less, perhaps, effect on him than otherwise. But he did seem to have a lot of difficulty with his feelings, being comfortable with himself, I mean, expressing positive and indeed negative feelings. Some of them are rather inchoate. He talks of rage and lust. He has difficulties talking about affection and love.
You have suspected yourself of a coldness.
I felt that I was always frightened of giving myself. I was always frightened of declaring love. And frightened of friendship, frightened of saying, you know, you are my friend, I like you, I
because?
Love you. Because I had no cushion, as it were, no infantile cushion to which I could refer when I entered into an emotional relationship. I think the situation now is that I have no friends. I suddenly wake up to the realization that I know nobody really, except my wife, and that possibly this small civilization of marriage is enough. That is not quite normal, I think.
Princess Road, in the Moss Side area of Manchester, was just one of various addresses where the young John Burgess Wilson grew up in the 1920s. His father remarried and inflicted on him a stepmother he strongly disliked. While she ran a tobacconist's shop, the father spent most of his life in pubs, for business as well as for pleasure.
My poor father used to play the piano in a pub. He also played in the old silent cinema, you know, and the kind of piano he had was rather like this. He never prepared his music beforehand. He always made it up as he went along, and he never saw the film he accompanied before the performance. So it was rather like this, you know, he'd be looking up at the screen and he'd be playing. Always.
study in a pub. He was pretty much the same. He used to play...
What kind of music did he play there? Popular songs?
Popular songs of the day, but, you know, songs that were sort of traditional.
And did he have to sing as well?
He did sing rather badly, as I sing. Something like this, you know. The song of twilight, when the lights are low, and the whispering shadows softly come and go. Though the heart be weary, sad the day and long, still to us the twilight comes love's old song. Badly, sung badly, but that's what they wanted.
At the age of 11, John Burgess Wilson won a scholarship to Xaverian College, a secondary school run by Jesuit priests. He made a return visit to the school in 1980 for Granada Television.
I remember my childhood was a matter of being frightened of hellfire, frightened of sex, frightened of sensuality generally, and this fear of life was, of course, perhaps appropriate to the climate. In my early days, up to the age of about 14, I daren't walk through the streets looking with pleasure, say, at girls who passed. To look at a girl was to lust after her, or so we were told. The great thing was to get to heaven if you could. And of course, Manchester helped. The weather always helped. The hard work always helped. The lack of colour and gaiety always helped. Get this life over as quickly as you could and get through, if you could, possibly, with a pass degree. Not with a high-flying honours degree, into the next world, say, thank God I've made it. Coming back into this room, which has not changed in, oh heavens, nearly 50 years, of course I become a schoolboy again, until I see myself in this mirror, see the changes. This was the room of punishment, and one came in here to be hit for infractions of the law. Here I was brought to argue, or rather to submit to my headmaster on the question of my own apostasy, my own leaving the church.
When Burgess cast off Catholicism, he wanted to cast off the whole idea that you could be predestined to be saved or to be damned. And Saint Augustine said that what mattered was your faith, that you were either saved because you believed in God or you were damned because in some curious way you had not accepted the church.
The Irish novelist James Joyce wrote only four major books, but perhaps uniquely for a great writer, all are accepted as masterpieces. Here, in the monitor cutting room, is the novelist Anthony Burgess, who wrote tonight's Joyce programme, working on the film, which was all shot in Dublin.
One of the great difficulties that I'm finding, looking at this film after, well, more than 30 years since we made it, is that it's difficult to disentangle the two writers in a curious sort of way, Joyce and Burgess. And I guess this is because Burgess did have this, this tremendous feeling of kinship for the whole undertow of Catholicism and exile and cunning.
He was a renegade. I myself, at the age of 16, was a renegade. He'd made his world out of the materials from the world he'd rejected. I wanted confirmation that the agonies and elation I knew as a renegade had some sort of artistic significance, meant something. I should imagine that when an Anglican loses his faith, it's a smooth and sweet process, rather like the shedding of a skin. His church has as good as told him not to take its doctrines too seriously.
No business to say that, of course, but one forgives him.
But for a cradle Catholic, to leave his church is like the wrenching of palpable bone and muscle. It's like the draining of the very contents of the skull.
Bit over the top, that shot.
To me, at an age when I could neither accept nor answer the arguments of the Holy Name Jesuits, it was unavoidable agony, because it seemed to be happening totally against my will. Anyway, it seemed to me that what I called reason was tugging one way, and emotion, instinct, loyalty, and fear were tugging the other. James Joyce summed it all up for me in A Portrait of the Artist.
Hell is a straight and dark and foul-smelling prison, an abode of demons and lost souls, filled with fire and smoke. The straightness of this prison house is expressly designed by God to punish those who refuse to be bound by his laws. In hell, all laws are overturned. There is no thought of family or country, of ties or relationships. The damned howl and scream at one another, their torture and rage intensified by the presence of beings tortured and raging like themselves. All sense of humanity is forgotten. The yells of the suffering sinners fill the remotest corners of the vast abyss.
Some would say that hell is loneliness, wouldn't they? Absolute isolation. And I think that although he lived a married life, there was a terrible, terrible solitariness that gnawed and tugged at him for an awfully long time, all the time I knew him anyway.
Was interested in all the arts as a boy. He won a prize for drawing. He didn't do much painting because of his color blindness, but he was interested in words. He wrote poetry, but it seemed that his greatest love was for music.
I was once in a very large Manchester pub with three singing rooms, they used to call them, three pianos going all the time. I first heard cacophony when I was a very small child, upstairs, trying to sleep, listening to three pianos. But also the fact was that Manchester, Blackpool, the North in general, is a curious sort of place where music plays, I think, a larger part in life than it does in the South. And living in Manchester again with an internationally known orchestra like the Halley, meant that I was drawn in that direction. Literature came very belatedly indeed, and it probably came through music.
I remember the incredible shock, pleasurable shock I had when I was a young boy. I'd made myself a crystal set. I remember hearing Debussy's L'Après-midi d'Enfant and being entranced by the wealth of colour, the subtlety of the colour, and I must do something like that. This is filling in the gap that has been left by not being able to appreciate genuine colour. He began teaching himself. He describes himself as an autodidact, and There's a line, he says, "Find middle C and you have found everything." And that's how he describes having taught himself to play the piano. One can only believe this. Remarkable story. He wanted to study music at the university. He found that he couldn't because he hadn't had a course in physics that was a requirement. So he ended up studying English literature instead, but did a lot of composing. After university, he was a music director in the Army, and he wrote many pieces for dance band and jazz band, all kinds of arrangements. And still it seems that his dream was always to become a composer.
At Manchester University, Burgess, the frustrated composer, immersed himself in literature. He also began to study phonetics and linguistics, which were to become a lifetime's fascination. Many years later, these studies helped him to create a language for Jean-Jacques Annaud's film Quest for Fire, an imaginative recreation of man's struggle towards civilization.
All we know is that our ancestors were not doing so what the Zulus did. They weren't using clicks like that. Get away, get away, get away. They weren't using that kind of noise. They weren't doing what the Chinese do. They weren't using a tonal language. Me or naha. They weren't doing that. They were using a language with heavy stresses. Bang, bang, bang. Fratro, fratro. And they were using languages with a lot of endings, you know, as in Latin. Mensa, mensa, mensae, mensarum, mensis, mensis. They were doing that sort of thing. And the sounds they were using were pretty well the sounds we have. So we can construct a language for these people 50,000 years ago, but we have to use a lot of guesswork.
Now, bring up! No! No!
We had regular sessions, you know, where we were going through my list of words that I needed, and we would pick either the Latin root or the Saxon root or the Germanic root.
Ulam. Ulam.
And we devised a very, very complex language with all the grammar. And I must say that all my crew, and of course my actors and myself, we could communicate in that language. And we were fluent in this language that we called Ulam. And we had a very interesting session with Desmond Morris, who was my consultant for body language, you know, that I still remember from those letters.
Bye.
Bye.
No, what is it? Sorry.
Bye.
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 Guy, that's good.
Guy.
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 I am hungry for tiger meat. They can build a big structure.
I am hungry for tiger meat.
Saya esachau vau satirstria, or sir esachai tirstria. I am hungry for tiger meat. Esachai vau, saya esachai vau satirstria.
He liked repeating the words to relish them. You know, like people would taste the wine, little sip, and then taste it in the mouth. So he had this pleasure with language. I remember him as a large voice saying, "Atra, atra, atra." Yes, it's good, it's good. It's the fireplace in your language. It's in your language. So well, maybe it's good to use more Saxon roots. No, Latin and Greek is better. So we had a lot of those roots, of course, in our language.
Yekta, vade. Algo. Yeka. No. Gnos. Atro. Sis. Naka Atra.
The movie was quite a success, especially in New York. And they interviewed people after the movie and they said, "Who is the director, do you think?" And everybody came up with Anthony Burgess. I was very flattered.
Young men who will undergo military training for 6 months of their 21st year come forward to fill up their forms. Inside labour exchanges throughout the country...
With the outbreak of war, Burgess was conscripted into the British Army, and in 1943, he was posted to Gibraltar.
For you, as for so many, the war, your experience in that war, was...
It was crucial. It was crucial. And not because of any privations. I'm lucky I survived. Mm. Some of my friends didn't. Mm. But I think what we began to feel in that war was how powerful the division was in England between the upper and the lower classes, how despised the working class was and the lower middle class, the shopkeeping class, which was mine, and how little our governors understood us.
I was a sergeant, and a sergeant major. In other words, I was in the ranks. And I felt toward the officers who gave me orders a great deal of contempt. If there's a question of taking sides, I'm on the side of the working class, because that's the class I come from. And, of course, the working class can be associated in my mind with Irish labourers who are Catholic, Soho waiters who are Catholic, and indeed a religion which is working class more than aristocratic.
I see you've all got the idea.
Burgess's task of teaching the British way and purpose, the Army's mission to explain the prospects of the post-war world, would later feature in the first novel he wrote, A Vision of Battlements.
He walked on, greeted by various grinning troops. It comforted him to think that there was something like affection in these greetings. It was affection won by a kind of hypocrisy, for in most of his talks to the units, he deliberately made himself a mere mouthpiece for the inchoate feelings of the many inarticulate. The talks were called bolshy, delightful old-fashioned word, but they were not really political. He invoked a vague golden age to come. They all, speaker and audience, knew it would never come, when wrongs would be righted, wives no longer seduced by the stranger in the land, Pole, Free French, American, work plentiful and beer cheap. It was all an opiate, but perhaps even a kind of poetry in which the act of expression meant everything, the content nothing. And so perhaps we can look forward to an age when real equality will be possible, when we workers will no longer be spat upon, spurned like so much offal, when the mighty will be brought low and the humble raised, democracy a reality, no longer a pious shibboleth. Such perorations often gained applause, sometimes cheers. The troops merely needed a voice, their repressions and grievances, the catharsis of a bard's utterance. Nobody really believed that the new city would ever be built.
While a student, Burgess had met Huella Isherwood Jones, generally known as Lynn, who became his first wife.
My first wife was Protestant Welsh. The Welsh, I think, on the whole, are more sexually given than the other Celts. I mean, the Irish drink, the Scots drink. They're not a very sexually minded race, either of them. The Welsh are given to that. My first wife honestly believed that free, indiscriminate sexual congress was not a bad thing, because this prevented one from identifying with love. She said love was a different thing altogether. She may have been right, but as we know, when we see, then the knife comes out. We can't so easily overcome our primitive instincts.
I wish I'd ever known what made Lynn tick, or for that matter, why they got married, except that perhaps they needed to, as it were, be a hone and a knife, just sharpen each other, or suffer from each other, or something.
After the war, Burgess became a lecturer in speech and drama at a northern training college. He failed once again to study music formally, and became an English teacher at Banbury Grammar School.
I think that he was probably a very stimulating teacher. And I know that people who were taught by him in the sixth form found him a very good teacher.
He always wore his academic gown. It was always flying behind him. He was rather slim, quite tall, very, very busy physically. And he impressed us all, I think. In this small group, there were just six or seven of us doing A-levels. I very strongly remember working on poets like Donne and Marvell and George Herbert. And looking back now, I think those were the most impressive lessons. Of course, we did Shakespeare with him, set books and so on. But we did these metaphysical poets, which none of us had ever, ever read any of this material before. And looking back, there is, of course, there the fascination with language that he loved to to use early Elizabethan and early English language in speech. He liked to read poems to us in the original pronunciation.
No, I am a lord. Oh, what a lord, peasant slave am I.
He had a rich, rather lovely voice. And he quite liked using it.
In a dream of passion, could force his soul sore to his own conceit, that from her working all the visage wan, tears in his eyes, distraction in his aspect, a broken voice, and his own fortune.
Burgess, still known as John Wilson, lived with Lynn in the nearby village of Adderbury, in a small cottage they named Little Gidding. Adderbury had a thriving tradition of amateur dramatics, in which he played an enthusiastic part.
This is where we held our plays and we did our play reading. And there's the piano that John Wilson used to play. If after the play reading he was in a good mood, he would play jazz. If he wasn't very pleased, he would play classical music. It was a village activity. Our second production was Juno and the Haycock, an Irish comedy. And John Wilson, alias Anthony Burgess, was our producer.
We were so few in numbers that he sort of had to take part. We didn't have enough members to cover the cast.
And his wife.
And his wife took a small part as well.
He was different to local village people. He liked to drink and frequent the Red Lion and the Bell.
He wasn't what the older members of the village expected.
I think his views were different. They often had arguments in the pubs, you know.
Yes. He would be quite forceful in his views.
Yes, he had different views to the locals, you know.
Banbury Grammar School had an extremely good dramatic society for old pupils, OBDS, Old Bamburians Dramatic Society. And when John Wilson was there, he produced, I think it was four or five plays. Well, this was the Chiltern Hundreds that he produced. And I remember I played this old man, it was my 21st birthday on the last night of the play. This was the thing by J.S. Eliot that I, Sweeney Agonistes, and I hadn't a clue what was on most of the time. I remember birth, copulation and death. But he wrote the music to this, under the bamboo, under the bamboo, under the bamboo tree. I can still remember most of the words, but it was a bit above me.
Under the bamboo, 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 under the bamboo tree. Two livers one livers two livers three. Under the bam, under the boo, under the bamboo tree.
He did Aldous Huxley, The Gioconda Smile. This is from the Oxford Mail in 1951. Mm. John Wilson is still obtaining remarkably good results from youthful material and is to be congratulated on another first-rate production. Mm. It was said that he quite often wrote his own reviews. He certainly wrote one of the reviews of his own books. After rehearsals, we had a lot of fun because we'd always go down to the local pub and he drank vast quantities of rough cider and never spirits and never beer. He'd get into the car, which was an open two-seater car, and as I took him back to his house in Adderbury, he would stand up, holding onto the screen, and shout into the wind passages of Chaucer, Elizabethan English.
A broken voice, and his old functions...
He came up with all sorts of reasons why it was necessary to do it. Everybody should shout into the wind.
What Hecuba to him, or he to Hecuba, that he should weep for her.
Several years after leaving Banbury Grammar School, Burgess published The Worm and the Ring, a novel closely based on his experiences as a teacher.
It's set in the school, which is quite clearly Banbury Grammar School. Some of the children are very well drawn, rather yobbish, And there's a trip to Paris, and the master, called Christopher Howarth, who is clearly John Wilson or Burgess, there's another one who is some people have identified as me, and they take a group of children to Paris, and they behave very badly. One of the children's knocked down, and he gets terribly drunk, and they have an affair. So I did actually go to Paris on a trip, but my husband came with me. So it was this rather dangerous mixture of fact and fiction. But was it safer to court Hilda Connor? Indiscreet, also double adultery. He saw her sturdy legs in hockey dress. Come on, girls. Yet he had smelt Schiaparelli's shocking on her, having first seen the vial in her handbag, and had admired the slim, blood-tipped fingers that gripped a vicious marking pencil. Her eyes had been warm lately. Her husband was away, a major of engineers, and she kept house with her mother, waiting for leaves and weekends. Her home in the village on the other side of the town was antipodal to his own. The name of the village, Rodforth, crackled in his mind, crepitated like silk underclothes. She would be marking maths books now, her body fallow. Did the coming of spring simmer in her? He turned back, sighing out smoke, to his task. It's so naughty, it's so full of half-truths, fictionalized, fantasy. It's so obviously a person, but it's just not correct. Though I did play hockey.
The school's former secretary, Gwen Bustin, also felt she'd been misrepresented by the novel. She took legal action, and Heinemann withdrew the book and had it pulped.
That was really quite an eye-opener, and a frightful scandal, of course, because he certainly didn't think that school secretaries were particularly involved with members of staff. So a lot of the suggestions in that book and the mention of sort of love affairs going on came to us as quite a shock, and we were inclined to disbelieve what were obviously the comparisons made with the staff in the grammar school.
I'm quite sure he was wrong about all of that stuff in The Worm and the Ring. Quite convinced. I knew all of the people he referred to, the young English mistresses and history mistresses, whatever. And I think this was a fantasy, perhaps one he would like to have seen. But I'm sure it wasn't. It was his fantasy, wasn't it?
Well, yes. I think we all thought that. But then underneath, you know, who knows?
He wrote letters and poems to me. He used to put them on the staff notice board, unsealed, with my name on the front. So everyone knew he wrote the letters and the poems, but that's all they knew.
In the summer of 1954, Burgess took up a teaching post in Kuala Kangsar in Malaya. He returned there in 1981 for the BBC series Writers and Places to reflect on this period in his life.
This is the place where I taught, the Malay College in the town of Kuala Kangsar. It was founded in 1905 as a kind of British public school for the sons of Malay sultans and rajas and chiefs. The Eton of the East, it was called. Soon, the college was democratized. The son of a paddy planter or fisherman or village medicine man was welcome so long as he was bright and earnest enough. The college still flourishes, but the British who built it have gone. Now, Malay teachers teach Malay boys in Malay, not English. But here is one British teacher who has come back, though only for a visit.
Kala. If.
If. How do you say it?
If.
Again?
If.
How do you say it?
If.
Again?
If.
Again?
If.
Is that right?
quite.
Is that right?
Yes.
Is that good?
Yes.
We are very lazy people in England. We are very lazy people. And when we pronounce our words, we do it rather like this. If you go up, we don't say, if you go up river, which is rather too, it's as though you're standing to attention. If you go up river, too strong. We are very slack. If you go up river.
Following his post in Kuala Kangsar, Burgess went north to Kota Bharu, where he now began to train teachers.
He made friends and tried to develop an insight into the people of Malaya. That made him different because the people that he was teaching with, my colleagues and his colleagues, we really kept to a European social scene. There was a European club. John Wilson joined the multiracial club in the town.
I came here as a teacher, but I left as a writer. I used to sit in Kadai's like this when my schoolwork was finished and sketch my first novel. I called it Time for a Tiger, borrowing the slogan of the beer I drank while I scribbled.
Why this urge to record Malaya in fiction? Surely it had been done before, and very adequately, by William Somerset Maugham. True enough, but it was very much an outsider's Malaya, the planters and their wives, bridge in the club and adultery in the district officer's bungalow. The Chinese and the Indians were very shadowy figures, and the Malays were reduced to a pair of obsequious brown feet on the veranda. However inadequate my own literary equipment might be, at least I got to know the people. Indeed, I got to know the Malays rather better than Joseph Conrad. I taught their sons. I spoke their language.
Time for a Tiger is the first of three novels, published under the pseudonym of Anthony Burgess, which became known as the Malayan Trilogy. The central character is an English teacher called Victor Crabb, who, like Burgess, is at odds with his wife Fenella, as he witnesses the last days of British colonial rule.
Crabb thought, I should want to go home, like Fenella. I should be so tired of the shambles here, the obscurantism, the colour prejudice, the laziness and ignorance, as to desire nothing better than a headship in a cold stone country school in England. But I love this country. I feel protective towards it. Sometimes, just before dawn breaks, I feel that I somehow enclose it, contain it. I feel that it needs me. This is absurd, because snakes and scorpions are ready to bite me. A drunken Tamil is prepared to knife me. The Chinese in the town would like to spit at me. Someday a Malay boy will run amok and try to tear me apart. But it doesn't matter. I want to live here. I want to be wanted. Despite the sweat, the fever, the prickly heat, the mosquitoes, the terrorists, the fools at the bar of the club, despite Fenella.
The Malayan Trilogy is very much a picture of the scene that we knew. I know of a number of instances from the book that are certainly drawn from real life, and I would say yes, it was an authentic picture of Malaya as I knew it in 1955.
I think the Malayan Trilogy, as a picture of hopeless, you know, colonial life, it's devastatingly good, I think. It's completely ruthless and merciless about what, you know, British imperialism, the fag end of it, does to people. And it's got a picture, a horrific picture of alcoholism in it, which is, I think, as good as anything, apart from Lowry, any 20th century writer's ever done.
Alcohol was already playing a large part in the Burgesses' lives, bringing them into disrepute with their fellow expatriates.
As a colleague of his, I never saw John misbehave one little bit. But our community in the teachers' college was very small and gossip was rife. So we had the impression of John Wilson and his wife that they were both rather scandalous characters who got drunk and did outrageous things. I was in their house once at the college And it had been John's responsibility to buy the meat for the evening meal. And Lynn said, "How many steaks did you get?" And he said, I got two. And he said, "Two? There's three of us, you big ape." That was the sort of type of person that I thought she was. She was, if you like, crude.
With his Malayan contract at an end, Burgess took up another teaching post in the East, this time in Brunei.
When I was there, it was evident that it was going to be a very rich state because of the massive oil deposits which were being developed and exploited. But I found the life there very frustrating, chiefly because the Malay subjects of the Sultan were aware that they did not have to work. The money was coming in from oil. They didn't have to learn. I was trying to teach them, and they didn't want to be taught. And there are other elements of frustration. My first wife was drinking heavily and making a nuisance of herself. We were always being picked up by the police and so on. And one day in the classroom, I decided that I had enough, let others take over. I just lay down on the floor, with a kind of interest, see what would happen. Then I was picked up and shoved into the local hospital. And various elementary tests were given, and then I was thrown home. And then eventually, my wife was told there is evidence of a cerebral tumour, but it is inoperable. And I don't know whether this is common, but she told me that they gave me a year to live. Mm. But I suddenly decided I didn't.
One possibility is that he was drinking heavily out in Brunei. He'd had a couple of fits, and in the medical situation that they had there, maybe he looked awful. There were one or two other neurological signs, and they put it down erroneously to a tumour. It happens in, or did then, in even more sophisticated societies than Brunei, so it's possible. And then when he came back here and they ran a few tests, they found it wasn't. If he's half the man we suspect he is, it was a God-given drama.
I didn't feel too bad about it. I felt it was not true. In any case, I'd been given a year. I've not been given a year since.
But you sat down and you didn't do
it.
Reach for the bottle. You sat down and started to write.
I sat down with a sense of duty to my prospective widow, and tried to make a little money. It was very difficult. You could never make much money with writing to fulfil what talent I had and produce the works I did.
Burgess, now aged 42, moved to the south coast town of Hove, where he managed to produce 5.5 novels in a single year. The fatal diagnosis proved false, and the threatened death of John Wilson proved to be the making of the writer known as Anthony Burgess.
I think it's very appropriate that everything has arrived here in Angers, a European city, which is both a crossroads of various European influences historically and also a center. I think Anthony always considered himself a European writer rather than simply a British or an English writer. And I think by nature, too, he was an exile. So to find a home, in a sense, away from home here in Angers, somehow brings together both those essential elements of his work, the exile and the Europeanness.
In Italy, in France, you don't feel, as you do in England, if you're a writer, that you're outside the general discourse of the community. You feel, in Italy, called professori, dottori, caro maestro, cher maître. Well, we have a place. Mm. In England, no.
In 1960, after beginning his full-time career as a novelist, Anthony Burgess, still known to his friends by his real name John Wilson, moved with his first wife, Lynn, to the small village of Etchingham in Sussex. They lived in a modest house called Applegarth.
I'm must have been one of the few people who actually got to stay with him and Lynn on a couple of occasions, which, shall we say, are not to be forgotten, because they lived in this unbelievably characterless little box of a house in Sussex, and one sort of took the train down and John would meet one at the station, and there would always be a call into the pub, you know, using it both as a pub and as an off-license, and the bottle of gin for Lynn. And then one went back, and really, his idea of an evening at home was to sit and absolutely go on drinking until you simply had to go to bed. He was, if ever I saw one, a natural novelist. I had him diagnosed as a Catholic long before I knew he was one. It takes one to know one. Obviously, he'd been drawing on the events of his life in the East, but also he had all these ideas about human nature, about the relationship between individuals and the state, between authority and freedom. And he was just bursting with all this stuff. And unlike most theorists, he could bring it into absolute individual examples.
Burgess was now publishing at the prolific rate of 2 to 3 novels a year. A Clockwork Orange appeared in 1962, followed by another futuristic satire, The Wanting Seed, dealing with the population explosion. He was so productive that he even had to resort to a second pseudonym, Joseph Kell. Although his books were not bestsellers, his publisher, Heinemann, held him in high esteem.
He was the ultimate pro. He delivered his manuscript when he said he was going to the length he said he was going to be, and you didn't put your pencil anywhere near it, if you had any sense. Some very bold Australian editor, I remember at Heinemann before my time, presumed to alter a letter in a Burgess manuscript. I think it may have been in the novel he wrote about Russia. It was called Honey for the Bears. And Burgess described at one point a crowd like formicating peasants. And this smart Australian thought that it was an error. And he changed the M of formicating to an N. And it went to the printer. Anyway, when it came back, Lynn Burgess, who used to proofread the books occasionally, there was a tremendous row that the ignorant editor had thought that Burgess's word formicating, which I think it refers to ants, spreading like ants or something, formicating, he'd meant the crude word fornicating. This was an outrage, and there was a huge row, and the editor had to step down. I think he went back to Australia or into a monastery or something. He loved Soho and he loved the pubs. And the form was that two of us from Heinemann went to the publicity director, who was about Burgess's age and an experienced pro, and me, and I looked after Lynn Burgess, his wife. That meant buying triple gin and tonics about every 7 minutes for the first 2 hours. And she could pick out if it was Gordon's gin or if it was proprietary gin they try and fob you off with. But Burgess didn't just leave you with that awful evening in front of you. He always would bring somebody interesting along or arrange to meet somebody interesting. And they were nearly always writers. One of the pub evenings, I encountered William Burroughs with Burgess, and I happened to buy him a drink, and he said, I'm very pleased to be here with Anthony Burgess. I greatly admire his Clockwork Orange. And, of course, that book was kind of ticking away, waiting to be filmed.
Long before Stanley Kubrick acquired the rights to A Clockwork Orange, the novel had caught the interest of the Rolling Stones.
Mick Jagger wanted to play Alex, and the Stones were going to play the Droogs. And they owned it for many years, I believe. But, I wasn't aware that Burgess was appalled by pop culture until I met him, of course, and then it became quite obvious in the first 3 minutes.
When we start thinking that pop music is close to God, then we'll think pop music is aesthetically better than it is. And it's only the aesthetic value of pop music we're really concerned with. I mean, the only way we can judge Wagner or Beethoven or any other composer is aesthetically. We don't regard Wagner or Beethoven or Shakespeare or Milton as great teachers. When we start claiming for Lennon or McCartney or the Maharishi or any other of these pop prophets the ability to transport us to a region where God becomes manifest, then I see red. There's nothing more delightful than to be told, you don't have to learn, my boy. There's nothing in it. Modern art, there's nothing in it. When you're told these things, you sit down with a sigh of relief. Thank God, I don't have to learn, I don't have to travel, I don't have to exert myself in the slightest. I am what I am. Youth is youth, pop is pop. There's no need to progress, there's no need to do anything. Let us sit down, smoke our marijuana, an admirable thing in itself, but not the end of anything. Let us listen to our records, and life has become a single moment. The single moment is eternity. We're with God. Finis.
In the early 1960s, to supplement his income, Burgess began to review books regularly. In the decades that followed, he became almost as well known for his reviews as for his fiction.
I introduced him to that famous place in Chancery Lane where you go and flog review copies. And he'd never known about that place before. And I noticed that thereafter he went at everybody for review copies. He tried to review as widely as he could. He did good, sharp, and funny reviews. He delivered to the right length, and he delivered on time. These are things that any literary editor would kill to get.
One day, instead of getting the usual huge parcel of novels for review, I received a single novel in a single parcel. This was my own, Inside Mr. Enderby by Joseph Kell. And I assumed that the editor wanted a bit of a joke. He wanted me to review this, but didn't want to make this request in writing, which might be too dangerous. So I reviewed the book. I said, as I remember, that it was not a book I would put into the hands of a child. It was rather a dirty book, but it had certain compensating qualities. And I thought I'd hear nothing more about it. But then I gathered that the Daily Mail got hold of it and various northern television channels, and I was fired, and I was fired from The Observer as unreliable. And I was very sad for a time because this business of reviewing one's own work has a respectable ancestry. Sir Walter Scott reviewed the first Waverley novel, I believe, in the Edinburgh Review. And I don't see why there shouldn't be something of immense interest in a writer who knows the faults of his work better than any other critic, pointing out what these faults are.
Burgess's creation, F.X. Enderby, was a disgruntled, neglected poet living a reclusive bachelor existence in Hove.
This was the order of a usual Enderby day. He would rise at dawn or just after, winter and summer alike. He would breakfast, defecate, and then work, sometimes beginning his work while actually defecating. At 10:15, he would shave and prepare to go out, sometimes with a shopping reticule. At 10:30, he would leave the flat, walk seawards, buy a loaf, feed the gulls. Enderby would then do such shopping as was needed. A loaf for himself, potatoes, 10 cigarettes, pickles, a small meat pie, a fourpenny custard. Back home, he would prepare his meal, or if something cold was left over from the day before, eat at once, working while he ate. He would then loll somnolent in a chair, or even, rolling dressed into bed, deliberately sleep. A way of life which harmed no one. Sometimes the caprices of the muse would disrupt this pattern by hurling poems, fragmentary or fully formed, at Enderby. Then, in mid-whiskey, in bed, cooking, toiling at the structures of non-lyrical works, he would have to write down at once to her hysterical or coldly vatic or telegraphic dictation. He respected his muse, but was frightened of her whims. She could be playful kitten or tiger fully clawed, finger-sucking idiot child or haughty goddess in Regency ball gown.
Her moods, like her visits, were unpredictable. More predictable were his other visitants. Dyspepsia in its various forms, wind, hiccups. Between dispensations of celestial and visceral afflation, he lived his quiet days, a solitary man, harmless. He envied nobody except the great, proved dead.
I was living in Borneo when I first conceived the character, and I think I was suffering from malaria or something that gave me hallucinations, and I opened the bathroom door one day in my little bungalow, and I saw a man sitting on the lavatory seat writing a poem. This is only for the fraction of a second, but the character stayed in my head and has stayed in it ever since. I could go on writing about this character forever, and I had to stop myself doing so by killing him off. But I keep thinking in the manner of Conan Doyle, who had to bring Sherlock Holmes back to life. Can I bring Enderby back to life, or at least can I write about his youth? This is a very strange thing, because the man doesn't exist. He never existed. He bears no resemblance at all to anybody who ever existed in real life, but to me he's very real, and to some extent he's myself.
That slightly shambolic bachelor existence that Enderby leads was a bit like Antony's, because it's as if he was too busy to bother about, you know, packing a suitcase, and he'd ram a few personal belongings into a supermarket carrier bag and jump on a plane and off he'd go. So there was something about the life that Enderby led which seemed to me to have certain echoes of Antony. But I think more importantly, the whole business of being a writer and of creating, and how poems arrived or how ideas arrived and were transformed by the writer's imagination into a work of art, I think was very close to him and his experience.
And he actually wrote a dozen poems which come in the appendix of one of the Enderby books. Well, they're wonderful for us prose writers. As I said, maybe I'll go back to writing poetry. He's shown me how to do it. It's getting the best of prose and enough of poetry, bringing it together, and I wrote two or three poems under the influence of Enderby, or his muse, that dreadful dominatrix who runs all through his works. We will not analyze his private life, as I know nothing about it, and my guesses are not worth sharing with the world.
Enderby always has problems with the women in his life, ranging from dominating, beautiful muses who seek to change him, to a terrible stepmother, much like Burgess's own.
In a sense, he had a sort of seminary child's fear of women, I think. And the stepmother is the earth as a kind of evil maternal force rather than a benign one. And the other women are versions of the muse. And the muse, in a sense, is deathly, just as much as the stepmother is deathly. In fact, only as I speak do I see that in many ways, until the second wife figure appears, women were death for Burgess.
She was the problem, really, because she was so difficult. She drank such a lot, and she was so aggressive and dangerous, and she would provoke these terrible rows, and there'd always be some clash at the end of an evening, sometimes before the end of the evening.
Lynn I liked, and what I saw of him in action with his wife was pretty good. He handled it pretty well, but it was difficult. The fact that they hadn't been to bed together, hadn't made love for a long time, weighed upon him in all sorts of ways.
I remember one evening when the bottles were empty, or when everybody was absolutely incapable, you know, we'd all reel off to bed, and I was in the spare room, only to be woken at 3 in the morning by the realization that I had my hostess on top of me with intent. Well, I mean, what, you know, the social book doesn't tell you what to do in those circumstances. So I figured the only thing to do was, as it were, to leave her to it and eventually probably she would go away. And in fact, both these things happened. And I thought to myself, does John know that she gets up to these games? And I think probably yes. He had this sort of enormous weight of guilt about her.
Despite repeated medical warnings, Lynn continued to drink heavily and suffered a number of serious hemorrhages.
It was a bit of a shock when I was summoned to the hospital where she was dying by a conclave of medical men who said, "How well do you know your wife?" And I said, I always thought very well. I've been married to her so many years. And then they said no more, but it was evident that there was a certain amount of guilt being attached to me for the situation she was in. Whether one should feel guilty about other people's actions, I don't know. How responsible we are for other people, I don't know. I still don't know. But I feel a genuine guilt in not knowing, in deliberately not wishing to know what was really happening, you know, from the clinical angle. For this, I didn't know. I deliberately, as she did, shut my mind to it. When she died, it was clear what had happened.
After his first wife died, he was really at sixes and sevens, he was always asking me how to cook things, because he couldn't cook. He asked me if I knew how to make a custard, and I thought, how can I tell Anthony Burgess how to make a custard? But that's what I did. And I used to go for walks in the street. After we would cook, we'd go for these long walks in the street, and he would rant and rave and almost bay at the moon in his grief for his wife, and he was really lost. And then Liana came along, and these two formed an instant union. I don't think with this drunken wife for years that he ever had any kind of sensual life like he did with her, and I think that was a huge turn on to him.
I didn't want particularly to meet him, because when you like so much a writer, you think it's irrelevant. You don't want to meet the person, but then we met, and we fell in love.
Liana Macellari was a professional translator who had been living in England studying linguistics. As Burgess recalled, they had met only once before, 5 years earlier.
I feel that with me it felt much more relaxed, you know, it was another, it was a new life, a new lease on life. I think that Anthony still felt, sometimes he was frightened, because he felt that he kept dreaming that his first wife would reappear and saying, but you know, you're married to me.
Burgess suddenly found himself with not only a second wife, but a young son who, as he later explained, he had fathered on his first meeting with Liana. At the age of 51, Burgess and his new family decided to leave England for Malta.
The few furniture we had got that it put together that we wanted to have in the house in Malta were not supposed to arrive there before 2 or 3 months. So we bought the Bedford caravan. It was a marvelous automobile. Then we decided to go very slowly to do the tour of the continent, France, Italy, and so on, the Grand Tour.
After driving through Europe, the Burgess family finally arrived in Malta in the autumn of 1968. But the Maltese authorities made their life difficult and even confiscated the books Burgess was sent to review.
My wife hated Malta, I hated it. I found there was too much censorship going on there. I made the next jump into Italy.
They settled in Bracciano, just outside Rome.
The peculiar nature of the writer's life is that he is not anywhere. He is not like the sculptor who needs a studio, a big studio, and settles down there with his big masses of stone.
He's a man with a typewriter and a wad of paper. And wherever he is, he wonders why he's there, why he's not somewhere else. And this tendency to wonder is one of the results of leaving England and going into exile. Exile is not really applicable to one country. I'm in exile in Italy. One doesn't say that. I'm in exile, and at the moment I happen to be in Italy.
When you make a documentary about somebody, it's a personal relationship very much. And he said, no, don't bother to stay in a hotel, stay in the flat. So I put up on a small bed. We just got drunk most of the time, actually. I just thought this was the most fantastic job to meet a writer I loved and get drunk with him. And I was sleeping on a tiny little put-you-up bed in just off the main corridor. And however late we'd finished the night before, and often it was quite late, Anthony would be up at sort of like 8:45, swinging his way towards the writing room, just on the dot. And when you know something about a writer's work, so every time I saw him head towards the bathroom, I just kept thinking about Enderby. So I saw everything in terms of his books, you know, and that made it rather difficult to see him, because I was completely obsessed with his writing. The thing that I took away from it was intense devotion to family, intense privacy, and when talking about himself, I think, as a lot of writers do, he had a sort of line. I was born in Manchester, I was a Catholic, I did this, I did. And it would come out just completely to order. Basically, there was a script, and to get behind the script was very, very difficult. But that's, of course, true of the books. When we say that a writer has a personality, we're probably saying exactly the same thing. That he's a very evasive character.
In 1971, Burgess moved to Rome, which became his base for the next 5 years.
I saw a lot of him when they lived in Rome. In those days, as a pretty much retired screenwriter from Hollywood, I was still offered practically everything in Italy that was going around, and I wasn't taking much of anything after Ben-Hur, and so I would recommend him, because he always needed money. And, you know, it's sort of... there'd be programs like the Medici Meet Four Angels and Job. Well, I think I can handle that, you know. I mean, I've got an idea about these angels. And he got fired from that one. He wanted real angels. And even the producers, Roman Catholic, corny Italian, said, well, we don't show real angel. Oh, of course you can. Of course you can. I will expect some. I've written real angels for you, you know. Just missed the point to everything. But he hacked away and made some money out of it.
Jesus of Nazareth was one of a series of biblical epics on which Burgess worked as a scriptwriter.
It was impossible to set up this project in Italy, for instance, without the Vatican knowing about it. Without indeed the chief rabbi of Rome knowing about it, without all the Protestant denominations knowing about it, without masses of advice, most of it unwanted, from theological advisors in the Radio Televisione Italiana. This has been the great pain, the great agony of trying to write a script, the interference. But it's amazing how, in spite of the interference, Christ seems to shrug it all off. The image of Christ remains. A man of considerable intelligence, without any doubt, whether he's the son of God or not is not the point of the moment, but he's a man of considerable intelligence, considerable political subtlety, and a man of very quick temper.
You scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites all, for you shut up the kingdom of heaven against men. You do not go in yourselves, nor do you let others enter. Blind guides!
But I see him more or less as T.S. Eliot describes in one of his poems, Christ the Tiger, Christ the Tiger, not gentle Jesus, meek and mild, but a man of tigerish temper, tigerish intelligence. exhorting people to love their enemies, but at the same time being most vehement about it.
Yours is a house of desolation, the home of the lizard and the spider. Serpents!
Of course, Christ has to say things which naturally there is no authority. There's no direct authority in the New Testament. I fancy that he has to talk to Mary Magdalene, the prostitute. He has to say things to her. There has to be a touching scene together in which they discuss the nature of physical love, and in which she says, "Why will you marry? Are you interested in women?" And he says something like, "Well, what woman would tolerate this life?" And she said, "I know one woman who would." And this gives us a sufficient kind of starting point for the notion that the Magdalene did follow the crowd at a distance, did possibly wash their clothes for them. But there's one thing that everybody just wanted to reject. Christ says to Magdalene, in my version, even our Father in heaven turns his back on what lovers do together. And this was meant to be a human touch, but I fear the forces of orthodoxy will want to reject it.
Increasingly in demand as a lecturer, Burgess made frequent trips to America, where he also found time to translate Cyrano de Bergerac, as well as turn it into a Broadway musical. He became a household name with the release of Stanley Kubrick's film of A Clockwork Orange. In the meantime, his own writing became more experimental.
He had this terrible curiosity about what to do with the novel. Shall I include photography this time and show photographs of puddles in a Roman street? That one worked very nicely. Never thought it would. Shall I translate Belli? Rather difficult, a trustworthy poet. He was just encyclopedic and very daring, and as things struck him, he did them. He was like a child. See, oh, that's a pretty thing. That's a good thing. Oh, let me play with this.
There is a danger that the intellectual fascination of the challenge can can undercut the effectiveness of the fiction. If you look at books like MF, where he brings in Levi Strauss, if you look at the Napoleon Symphony, where he tries this impossible, seems to me impossible task of writing a novel exactly like a musical symphony, these enterprises seem to me to be willed rather than intuited, that there's a sense of, I will tackle this problem.
He's tried to musicalize the novel by basing a novel in some literal way on a pre-existing musical form. The form was Beethoven's Eroica Symphony. What he set out to do was create a novel in four parts, with those four parts matching, both in length and in tone, the movements of that symphony. The famous funeral march, the second movement of the Eroica, he set words to that, and that's how he begins the second chapter of Napoleon Symphony. He tries to keep the pace of the third movement moving faster than in the other movements. And I think to a certain extent he does that, for even by the very way that the third movement begins, the third chapter, I should say, of the book begins. To bivouac, to bivouac, to bivouac, to bivouac, to bivouac, to bivouac. Hard to say whether it totally succeeded, but that perhaps more than any other Burgess book reflects this creative world in which music and literature coexisted as equals. And to try to musicalize a novel, it's a fantastic idea.
What fascinates us all about music, and fascinates me more and more as I get older again, is the fact that here we have pure form. We have nothing but form. There's no content. You can't say this symphony is about this, as we can say this novel is about that. I think there's something in sheer form
which is a kind of salvation, that the mere shaping of things...
Who refused to play and then said, well, if I play, I should play badly. And Burgess afterwards said she certainly did.
Burgess became a one-man Joyce industry, writing book after book, and even unravelling the complexities of Finnegan's Wake for American television.
Have you heard of one Humpty Dumpty, how he fell with a roll and a rumble and curled up like Lord Oliver Crumble by the butt of the magazine?
If Burgess would provide him with a substantial orchestral work, his orchestra in Iowa would perform it. And Burgess decided he would write a symphony. One thing one finds in Burgess's music over and over is a kind of angularity and a great use of the interval of the fourth in his harmonies, the opening harmony of this piece. You hear that, the fourth and the fifth, followed immediately by more of them, and then a tune. One finds this over and over in his music. We associate this chordal harmony also with Hindemith, and so I see a real tie between Hindemith's music and Burgess's music. It was premiered October 22nd, 1975, and Burgess described that as the great artistic thrill of his life, and I think that moment, hearing a full orchestral performance of a symphony, is what led him on to compose so much music in the last two decades of his life, because after that, the music simply poured out of him.
It is what they call post-tonal. It uses a regular orchestra, regular bar lines. The rhythms are irregular. It is not Pierre Boulez quite. It doesn't avoid melody. It is, I think, occasionally euphonious. It is well structured.
There wasn't as much experimentation in his music, perhaps, as there was in his writing. How he wrote? Well, he loved the feel of the paper and the pens, and he talks about how he would like to get himself set up properly with the large manuscript paper and go to it with the pens. There's very few examples of musical sketches.
Taught me never to use a pencil when I'm composing. Otherwise, you just go back and erase and start getting lazy. So he always told me to use a pen, and I seemed surprised at that, and I, but why? If I make a mistake, I better start all over again. Exactly. In that case, you'll think twice before you write something. Unless you can afford to throw away manuscript paper.
It doesn't drive me mad. I saw Anthony writing every day. That's what he posed to himself as a task. And he wanted Andrea also, he said, write a fugue, bring me a fugue. And I think that Andrea found it. No, difficult. It's very hard to write a fugue.
Very difficult.
So it was a discipline. Sometimes I think he did that in the evening, not in the morning, or sometimes in the morning, or does he give a date?
Well, it's so interesting that many of them have a date. Almost all of them have a date. Not all of them have a time. But look now, Anna, the fugue. 9:50, he writes the time that he finished it. Then we go on to the next prelude. 19:21, the fugue. 21:19, and that last little prelude, 22:19. To such precision, and so this day seemed to be so prolific.
I don't know how good the pianist he was, but he never used it after the piano because he wrote from the brain.
Burgess's love of popular music was most fully expressed in The Blooms of Dublin, a musical play based on Joyce's Ulysses. It was recorded by BBC Radio in Dublin for the Joyce Centenary in 1982.
Today, it's the 16th of June. Today, and from morning till moon, the hours to come will add up to a humdrum summer's day.
When it was reviewed, people treated it as though it was an opera. It wasn't an opera. I mean, it was, as he said, a demotic work. He was using a longer word, perhaps, where a shorter word, or a more accessible word would have done, like a popular work. And it's a very popular work, and full of musical jokes.
Population without population, that is our need and our desire. May God preserve the condom, the peasantry too, of course, but hasten the day when we can slay the life force at its source.
The chorus and the orchestra refused to play the music which accompanied Copulation Without Population. It offended people's religious feelings, and I remember there was one lady who refused to play, and then she said, well, if I play, I should play badly. And Burgess afterwards said she certainly did.
Burgess became a one-man Joyce industry, writing book after book, and even unravelling the complexities of Finnegan's Wake for American television.
Have you heard of one Humpty Dumpty? How he fell with a roll and a rumble, and curled up like Lord Oliver Crumble, by the butt of the magazine wall, hump, helmet and all. He was one time our king of the castle, now he's kicked about like a rotten old parsnip, and from Green Street he'll be sent by order of his worship to the penal jail of Mountjoy. To the jail of Mountjoy, jail him and joy.
I think back of it was that he was a frustrated musician. And he saw that Joyce, who was known to be a rather good tenor singer, and much interested in music, that this was one thing that they had in common. And he sort of felt, I am of the school of Joyce. Well, I think he was rather better than James Joyce, and certainly more interesting to read. And I always thought that although this was kind of fun, it was, he rather overdid it.
We had chaw chops, chairs, chewing gum, the chicken pox and china chambers, universally provided by this soft soaping salesman. Small wonder he'll cheat Erewhon, our local lads nicknamed him, when Chimpton first took the floor with his bucket stop store down Bargain Way Glore.
In Joyce, it's a kind of madness, it's a phobia. Not a phobia, it's a mania. This linguistic lust that he had, I haven't quite got that. We've learned from Joyce how to control it to some extent. But when we use an ordinary word, it's crammed with allusions, it's crammed with ambiguities. If I use the word violence, the word violence contains the word vile, which means a violin. The notion of harmony contained in the notion of discord.
James Joyce, I thought, summed up in one word in Finnegan's Wake. He used the word crops, and you have to look at the word rather than just hear it. C-R-O-P-S-E. So there we get, you know, the word corpse in a kind of metathetic form, and then crops, and the two opposites are brought together in a single word. This is the magic of language. But nobody, I think, in his right mind, goes quite as far as Joyce did.
And not all the king's men nor his horses will resurrect his corpus, for there's no true spell in Connaught or Hell that's able to raise a cane.
Well, here at Stationers Hall, celebrations are in full swing for the news that the 1980 Booker Prize for Fiction has been won by William Golding.
And not by Anthony Burgess, whose novel Earthly Powers had seemed a strong contender. In many ways, Earthly Powers was Burgess's most ambitious book to date, with a narrative encompassing the entire history of the 20th century.
I was trying to write a big book in the old Victorian manner, in which there's enough scope to deal with many human characters, many places, and big themes. The kind of novel we have coming out now mostly deals with the manners of people living in very parochial societies. Deals with England as England is now, which is not of any great interest either to the future or to the outside world. I think the novel is a universal form which should make as big an appeal as it can. Think of, you know, Ulysses, War and Peace, etc. We're aiming too low in the contemporary fiction, and I was trying to aim rather high.
It was the afternoon of my 81st birthday, and I was in bed with my catamite when Ali announced that the Archbishop had come to see me.
Earthly Powers is narrated by Kenneth Toomey, an elderly homosexual writer who feels estranged from the Catholic faith. Toomey's life becomes involved with that of Carlo Campanati, a priest who is made Pope and is subsequently a candidate for sainthood.
I think Earthly Powers is one of the masterpieces of our time. I also think it's a book that will last. He himself said at the time when it came out that nobody appeared to have realised that it was a parodic book, that it was not an attempt to write a great, serious, epic modern novel. It was an attempt to write a modern novel that took the form of a parody of, say, The Godfather, of the filmed blockbuster which was pulling out every stop on the cinema organ about good and evil, with music in the background and angels wailing. And it is, in a sense, a fictive history of the religious life of our time coming up against mass evil, like the concentration camps.
There would be no need for me to pore over the photographs in the parcel from the Ministry of Information that I had not yet opened. There was no ghastliness perpetrated in the real world that a man did not already know from his dreams. Christ on the cross with a hole in his side and the hole used. Penetrationis causa membrorum virilium centurionum Romanorum. The smashed womb and the filthy slogan written in bits of entrail. No limit. Semen in the skull, the sexual apparatus torn out at the root and stuffed laughingly up the anus. The Nazis had, in a quantitative age, exploited the horror of surfeit. That was their sole new achievement. But meanwhile, and I did not know this yet, though our great war leader knew it, the guns were being oiled to place in the hands of children to kill the shiploads of returning Russians, victims of Yalta, as they were to be called. Human flesh was not precious. Plenty more where that came from. Men with nose masks on tractors would plough it all in for nourishing of the soil. A ballet of blind beseeching as thin limbs were animated by the advancing engines, then thrust down into the slow economy of nature. I wanted to have Carlo with me there, to smell the ripe gorgonzola of innate human evil, and to dare to say that mankind was God's creation and hence good. Good, that's what I am, sir. It was the devil made me do it. Man was not God's creation, that was certain. God alone knew from what suppurating primordial dung heap man had arisen.
Earthly Powers had made a great impact. It had been the book which famously almost won the Booker. And I remember that a few years later, when I was responsible for editing his novel Any Old Iron, it won the Northeast Book of the Year Award. And we went back up to Manchester to a dinner where the award was going to be announced. And Anthony said, you know, this is the only literary award my country has ever given me. And that was both a reflection of the fact that he was regarded as a remarkable jack of all trades, but master of none, and of the real bitterness, I think, he felt, that he hadn't been recognised in some way. I think it would have been sufficiently been recognised as a composer, if not as a writer, but that on all counts he hadn't been given his due. And I think he was right.
He was angry, and I suppose he was of a generation that minded about public honours. I mean, if the creator of that bastard Lucky Jim could become Sir Kingsley, then why should not Burgess have been recognised? And I said to him what I believe was true. This is almost entirely simply because you live abroad. People don't notice you in the daily round of life, and this is a great strength to you as a writer.
From 1976, Burgess took up residence in Monte Carlo, in the Principality of Monaco. One of his neighbours, also in exile on the south coast of France, was Graham Greene.
He looked at Greene, who had had major bestsellers, who had been honoured, and whose reputation was certainly higher than Burgess's ever had been. And he felt that from the fact that one was a convert, whereas he, of course, was a cradle Catholic, onwards, there were real differences between them, and in each case, there are differences which abounded against Greene and in his favour.
I had to do an obituary for Graham Greene for The Late Show, and they said, well, Anthony Burgess is the man, because Anthony had done that famous interview with him, of which Greene said he put words into my mouth that I never knew existed. I don't think they were on fantastically good terms after that piece.
What's your final estimation of his stature as a writer? Is he a great writer, do you think?
Well, I don't... unfortunately, should not say this now. One should not say anything bad of the dead. But I think the time will come in a few months, or possibly a year, when people will begin to consider his stature as a writer. I don't think it's very high, myself. I don't think it's as high as that of, say, Evelyn Waugh.
He proceeded to make a pretty lively attack on Greene. I think that's why he has the reputation of this slightly dyspeptic personality, because I think in public he was a guy who said exactly what he thought.
Greene was practically canonized, and therefore anybody who was a bit contrarian or satirical would want to criticize Greene, because you have to take the saint down a few notches. It's essential. But I think that, in fact, he was quite generous towards other writers, which is rare, as you know. Most writers hate other writers and will never say a good word about anybody. So I don't think that Burgess was that way. And as a critic, when he looked at another person's book, he looked at that book accepting the givens of the book. I mean, when you read his collected essays, he wrote vast amounts of criticism, and it's very fair criticism. He doesn't attack the premise of a book, which many critics do. He accepts the premise and then he goes from there.
I can't think of another writer like him, where even the weekly reviews are as much part of the man as the novels or the poems or the screenplays. Maybe to do with the way he uses language and the particular stamp he places on a sentence. He was a superb stylist, and it's a very muscular and fluent style he has. Perhaps best exemplified in a book like Nothing Like the Sun, where he writes in a kind of cod Shakespearean that seems so real that you almost imagine this is how Shakespeare might have thought or conversed.
I am near the end of the wine, sweet lords and lovely ladies, but out there the big wine is being poured, thin, slow, grey. Never more shall I taste the oncoming of this particular darkness, but I shall not be sorry to go. I am not seduced to this life by the dainty lusts, clothed in cold green and clean linen of an English spring. If you plunge into that dark there, you will emerge at length into a raging sun and all the fabled islands of my east. And that is what I shall be doing tonight, off like a bird. I see you have your pennies ready, ladies. Twitch not, hop not about, nor writhe so. I shall not be long now.
He came to the Cheltenham Literary Festival to give the European lecture, which was on translation. He came up to me just before going on to a stage in the town hall in Cheltenham. There was a full house, about 1,000 people. And he said, well, I saw my doctor, my expert, earlier today. I've been told I've got cancer. And he then went on and rehearsed an idea which he gave in the lecture about he himself was shortly to be translated, and that led into the theme of the translation, which was the talk.
He kept saying one never knows the hour nor the time. So he felt that he had to justify being alive by working. This is some sort of testament written by him, which ends in a very terrible way, because it says, time is terribly short, time is shortly terrible, terror is short and timable. And this, I think, it was a long time before he discovered that he had a cancer tumor, that he would vomit blood, in effect. But this is a negative sign, if you want, the fear side, but on the other hand, he always believed in this unquenchable human soul and this coming back to life. I think that this is the positive side, that you feel the message of energy and optimism and creativity that you find in his writing, and this is what I like so much.
Anthony Burgess died of lung cancer on the 23rd of November, 1993. He was 76 years old.
The moving thing about Burgess's tombstone is this wonderful phrase, Abba, Abba, which is what Christ said on the cross, and which is the title of his book about Keats. And so it is a phrase out of the Bible which any man might say at the moment of death. It is purely Burgess's own, because it has the immortality of the circle in the phrase ABBA, ABBA. It's an infinite repetition, it's a closed circle, it's a beginning, it doesn't have an ending. It's a good tombstone.
I think the turnout at the memorial service and the whole emotion showed that people suddenly realized just what they had lost all of a sudden, that we thought Anthony would go out producing three books a year and a weekly column and so on forever and ever. And so there was a tremendous amount of affection and you know, regret at his passing. But there was a wonderful moment, because it was at the Covent Garden Church, the Actors' Church, and it backs onto the piazza at Covent Garden. And towards the end, after we'd heard music and speeches and all that sort of thing, in the piazza, some sort of, I don't know, musical group started playing Roll Out the Barrel, an old pub song that I'm sure Anthony could have thumped out on the piano himself. We all smiled because it was such a sort of Burgessian moment, and you knew that had he been there, he would have enjoyed it. It was like a return to his early days in Manchester, where he lived above a pub.
The song of twilight.
And it seemed just so apt that we all filed out of the church with grins on our faces.